I guess that nobody, so everybody here knows him, and everybody who have heard something about process mining also knows the name of Bill van der Waals because of his books and his activity and his papers. And so also my great pleasure is to greet Will here because he is a honorable professor of our university. And so just for some time we were working together quite intensively. So still I was, of course, we are in the same field, so just I hope for different continuations. And today the topic of the talk is also very interesting and concerns topics already which we are already here, so about PetriNet extensions. And this time there will be objects, which is really interesting and challenging because all of us, we do feel that we do need something like this for practical applications. And it is a challenge to find this compromise, I would say, so that still have a formal background for all this and enough expressibility. So we are looking forward to hear this talk. You're welcome, Will.
Thanks a lot, Irina. Let me try to share my screen. Now you see my slides, right?
Yes.
Yeah, perfect. Yeah, so thanks for the introduction. So my goal is to talk about two topics. And basically, one topic is extending PetriNets, driven by requirements from process mining. And the other one, and the other direction is to again limit it to PetriNets that have specific properties. The first part will be more application oriented. The last part will be more theoretically oriented, without going into a lot of details. So as Irina just said, I have very nice memories to, let's say, all the visits that I made to Moscow. I'm not sure how long ago is it that this picture was taken? Was that to 2016 or so?
15.
Okay. Yeah. So I'm happy to contribute to this seminar. And as I said, the topic of today is based on two papers. One paper has been published. The other paper is under review already for quite a while. And the paper about discovering object-centric PetriNets is basically extending PetriNets, not with full coloring, but limited coloring that comes from IDs related to process mining. The other part is to limit PetriNets to those PetriNets where different markings are distinguishable. What I mean by that, I will explain that in a minute. And so one extends, the other limits. And let's say the topic of this lecture series is to talk about different, PetriNet-based modeling languages, and I felt that this fitted nicely. You all know this famous quote by Albert Einstein, so everything should be made as simple as possible, but no simpler. And that relates a bit to the topic that you find if you're working on machine learning, if you're working on data science, that you are trying to find the model and you pick a representation. And the choice of the representation is very important. And earlier, I defined a PhD project with the title that you see here, Don't Search for the Undesirable, Avoiding Blind Alleys in Process Mining. And this PhD project was about finding the right representational bias, which is a very common topic in machine learning. It is not that common in the field of PetriNets to talk about it in this way. But this led to the work of Sander Leemans, And I think most of you have used the inductive miner in the past. And the inductive miner is able to do certain things because of the representational bias of process trees. Things like soundness and stuff like that are there by construction, but at the same time, you can model skips. So that's the setting a bit. And what I will talk about, on the one hand, it relates to PetriNet theory. On the other hand, it is inspired by applications from process mining. So I'm going to click you very quickly through, what process mining is about. Not to explain, the value or the importance of process mining, but to talk a bit about the assumptions. And then I will say that these assumptions may not be the best ones. So we all know what event data is. An event is something that has happened. And if you apply process mining, you take as input event data. And if you are interested in the control flow, only three fields are important. And so an event may talk about money, it may talk about location, it may talk about products. But the things that typically are used to uncover the control flow are just three elements. That's the case identifier, the activity, and the timestamp. I think most of you, if not all, know this very, very well. But this is the assumption that we make. And if you make that assumption, you can basically create a trace for every case in the process. And so if I look at a certain order, 6,350, I look at that order, then that corresponds to the blue trace that we see here. And if we look at that trace, then we see that that is happening over 8,000 times. At the bottom, you also see, traces that are less frequent. In other words, there are fewer cases that have this particular sequence of activities. Nothing new. If you have that, then you can, then there are dozens of techniques, if not hundreds, to take such data and to convert it into process models. And most of the process discovery algorithms are using PetriNets either during the discovery phase or at the end to show the process in terms of a PetriNet. So here you can see some. If you look at the PetriNet at the bottom, this is basically a process tree converted to a PetriNet. And you can see that because it is block structured. And for example, we can skip activities using these silent transitions. So this is nothing new. You all know that, and then you can show what is going on, how often are there certain paths being executed. Because we have timestamps, we know where the bottlenecks are. So we all get this for free. We can also take either a normative process model or the process model that is describing the majority of the traces, and we can see the deviations. And using process mining, we can now, for example, see that there are, if we look at the frequent process in blue, then we see that there are these 37 exceptional cases where people had paid the invoice before getting it, right? That's things that we all know. So in everything that I just spoke, and if you would like to see more about that, there are, thousands hours of videos available explaining this in much more detail. But all of this is based on the fundamental assumption of having a case ID. You could also call it a process instance. So there are over 35 commercial providers of process mining software. There are many open source tools. There are thousands of organizations using this technology, and it is all based on the assumption that we have event data and every event is referring to one case. So this leads to process models, as is visualized here, where a case goes in. So a case starts, that could be an order. This could be a COVID patient that is treated in the hospital. This could be a bag that you check in at the airport. So it starts and it ends at some stage, right? That's nothing new. That is completely standard. In reality, of course, what process mining, why is it so popular? Why do many people use it? Is that process mining shows that these processes are much more complicated than what I'm showing you here. And so simple administrative processes may have thousands of different executions, which is providing valuable information how you can improve that. But I'm not going to talk about this. I'm going to talk about the assumption. Everything that happens, happens with respect to a trace. And I would like to show that that is not the case. So now I change scenery and I'm looking at like an example, for example, ordering routes from Amazon. And if I look at the activities of handling orders by a company like Amazon, I'm not sure what the counterpart in Moscow would be called, but I'm sure that there are similar, let's say, stores where you can buy lots of products electronically. And you can place one order, but this one order will often contain multiple items. So I place one order, and in this example, in this single order, there are four items, right? Nothing surprising. So I place the order at a particular point in time. It contains four items. And now the difficulty arises that some of the things that I do are at the level of an order. For example, if I make a payment, I may pay the entire order in a single payment, right? But there are other things that are happening at the item level. And so Amazon is going to check, okay, is this particular book, is that in stock? If it is not in stock, then we need to get it from another warehouse, et cetera, et cetera. So other activities are at the item level. Then Amazon is combining items that are available and ships them in packages. And in one package, there can be multiple items. And the difficult part is that in one package, there may be items of different orders. And so if on the same day, I place first an order of I don't know, three books, and later I place an order with four more books, I may get a package with all seven books or any subset of it. Then there are deliveries and routes. So the packages are combined. You try to deliver them, and this may or may not be successful. So the same package can be on multiple routes if people are not there. So I hope that this sets the scene for let's say, a more realistic view. So what is now my case ID? Is my case ID my order? Is the case ID at the level of an item? Is the package the case ID? Is the route the case ID? And that leads to difficulties. This is like a visualization if I would look at the object model at the instance level. And so, for example, you can see that there is so order one consists of three items. And if we look at package one, it also has three items, but these are items corresponding to two different orders, right? And order one is not delivered in one go. Order one is delivered in two packages. So there are these one-to-many and many-to-many relationships that we all, let's say, immediately see if we would draw a data model for this. So if we try to discover process models, we cannot use a classical Petri net using a single case assumption as you would do in a let's say standard workflow net. Because in a standard workflow net, if you have a transition with multiple input arcs, you assume that you only consume tokens that I don't know, correspond to the same order, to the same customer, to the same item or whatever. But what you see here is that we have the flow of orders, we have the flow of items, we have packages, etc. So this is what we are trying to achieve. If you accept this, that we cannot assume to have an event log where every event is referring to one case, we can relax the assumption and say that an event consists of an activity, a timestamp that is as before, but next to an activity and a timestamp and possibly other attributes like, I don't know, costs and whatever, it is not referring to one case, it is referring to a collection of objects. So if I place an order, that order refers not only to that order, but also to the items that I'm ordering, right? So we lift the event notion from something referring to a single case to something that is referring to any number of objects, right? That's the assumption that we gave. And so if I show in the table, then we have activity, this is as before, we have timestamp, this is as before, we can have attributes like price and weight. That's also nothing new. What is new is that rather than having one case identifier per event, we can have any number of objects, right? That's assumption that we are taking. And objects have types. So we have here, for example, objects of the type order, objects of the type items, objects of the type customers, etc. Yeah, so I hope that this is clear. So you need to accept this assumption that I now assume my event data looks like this. And objects can be anything, like it's a much more general concept, because one event may refer to machines, to rooms, to locations, to customers, whatever. And that's what we do. And so it's a very flexible thing. And this is what we then assume. And so here are some examples, but I think it's obvious. So place order may refer to multiple events, but the pick item event refers to, of course, only a single item. If we have a failed delivery, so you try to deliver a package that is containing certain items, then that failed delivery, of course, applies to all the items that were in the package, et cetera, et cetera. So we do not need, if we do this, we do not have a single case identifier, but we still want to do process mining. So what is the way that people do this today? Because what I'm explaining is not a new problem. It's a problem that everybody that is applying process mining in practice is facing. You go to a system like SAP and it will be loaded with these types of problems. So what do people in practice do? They pick an object type as the case notion. And so in other words, they select a particular view. And what they then do is that they, if they pick a particular view, then they basically, if in that view, so for example, if we take place order and the multiple items, we replicate that event for every item. And I will visualize that in a minute. But that's the basic idea. So if I pick orders as a case notion, this row corresponds to a single event. If I take items as a case notion, then this row in the end will refer to two events referring to different cases being different items. That's a basic idea. If there would be no objects of a particular type, then we would not see it if we would take packages as a case notion. So just to visualize this, although I think it's very simple, let me also switch on a pointer. And so for example, if we take orders as a case ID and we look at this event, this row, send package is referring to multiple orders. If we have something like this, and we take orders as a case ID, then that means that we need to duplicate this row. If we take items as a case ID, And then we are taking this row as our case notion. And then we need to duplicate this event place order twice and pack, send package three times. If we take packages as a case idea, like there are many, many events that kind of disappear because they do not have a corresponding reference to a package. And so this is super simple, and that's the way that we are doing this, let's say today. So this mapping of taking events that are referring to multiple objects and taking a case ID and then creating a traditional event log has three problems. Deficiencies, events may disappear. Convergence means that you unintentionally duplicate events, leading to problems. And divergence, that is most complicated to explain. That means that things are happening in a very strict structured order, and that ordering gets lost in the conversion. And I will again show these problems graphically. So the first of the two problems that I would like to elaborate on is convergence. So in reality, we had one send package event. And if we pick items as a case ID, then we receive one package, but the package contains three items. And if we say items is the case ID, then we see that this event is replicated three times. So if I now create a process model and I look at costs and frequencies, etc., these things are wrong, right? Because only one package was delivered. But in our data, we now see three rows corresponding to different send packages. So this is the convergence problem, and that's easy to understand. The second problem is the divergence problem. And that is, let's say, one of the reasons next to concurrency for creating spaghetti diagrams. Yeah, so if people have applied process mining, what comes out is often called spaghetti. And that has the following reason that I try to visualize here. So here I picked orders as my case ID, but there were events that were taking place in the context of an order, but that were referring to different items. Yeah, so this pick item event is part of this order and it refers to this item, but the order was consisting of three items. So we also find pick item events for all three items. So for all three items, we see a pick event and a pack event. If we look at the item level, the order is very strict. You always, so for example, if we look at this order, we always first do the pick, and then a bit later we do the pack, right? So now I do my standard convergence, and here, because in every row there is just one order, I don't need to change anything. We already have a clear case notion. But what we now have is that, so for example, this pick item was corresponding to this pack item later. This pick item, if you look at my mouse, was referring to that pack item. So for every item, every pick event was followed by a pack event. But if I now take orders as my case identifier, I can no longer distinguish this, right? Because I chose as level of granularity orders. So what I see is I see pick followed by pick. I see pick followed by pack. I see pack followed by pack. I see pack followed by pick. So I see all the orders that are possible. Although at the item level, there was always a pick followed by a pack. So I hope that this shows that these models are not the models that we would like to see. This is creating spaghetti. The divergence problem, the convergence problem is let's say, leading to incorrect numbers because the frequencies and the costs, etc., are incorrect. So, as I said, this is not a new problem. This is, I don't know, as old as process mining is. But as process mining is getting more and more applied, it becomes more and more visible that this is a huge problem. So if you look at data models, whatever notation that you use and whatever data model you look at, most of the relationships are one to many or many to many. There are very few relationships that are one to one. So if you look at any information system, this problem is everywhere, right? It is not like an academic invention. Look at any real process and you will be able to see these problems. And these problems are kind of hidden because before people do process mining, they have converted the event data and they are using a particular view. These are the problems that we are facing. So one of the things that we did here in the new process mining group in Aachen is that we developed a new standard called OCL, which stands for object-centric event logs. So our goal is to promote this as a new standard, just like XES is a standard, where we are storing data at a level that is closer to reality. As I said, I'm not going into a lot of detail. Here you see the meta model of OCL, and like you also see, let's say, the standard document that was released, let's say, a few months ago. So now we are taking OCL as input, and you're still thinking, what does this have to do with PetriNet, right? But I will come to that. So if you accept that this is a reality that we are facing with, then we need to somehow work with data where every event is referring to multiple objects. And then there are three, let's say, different approaches. The first approach is what people do today, specifically in industry, when they extract data from, for example, SAP, is that they extract the data, and while extracting the data, they are picking a case notion and they are doing the duplication. Yeah, so that's what people do now. What we concretely propose to people in industry already today is that they should not do this. They should store the data, not directly in XES, but they should store the data in this OCL format. So this OCL format is somewhere in between the data in real systems and the data that you find a process mining tool can load. If you start it like that, then you can still flatten it and use traditional process mining techniques, but this has the advantage that each time you choose your view, you can, for example, take the customer view, you can take the supplier view, you can take the order view, you can pick different views. And each time you have a certain view, you can generate a new event log and load that into your favorite process mining tool. So this is what people already can do today with little effort. And the part where we are doing research on here in the group in RWTH Aachen, and then you saw the names of the people involved earlier, is to not first convert the data, but to directly mine PetriNet from them at a higher level of abstraction, taking into account the different types of objects. So I'm not going to, for me, it's more important to pose the problem and to make you aware that there is this standard. I just, let's say, show some screenshots of, let's say, based on the paper that I showed at the beginning, that we now have techniques to learn object-centric PetriNets. So these are, you can think of them as color PetriNets, where every place is corresponding to an object type, and every token is corresponding to an object. So we stay very faithful. Places correspond to object types. Tokens correspond to objects. A transition firing corresponds to an event. So we are doing this in a very faithful way. We had our original data, and our data is directly mapped onto these PetriNets. What that means is that you get arcs in your PetriNet, which you can think of like multi-set arcs, the same as you can do that in CPN tools, for example. Along the arcs, if package delivered executes, it consumes all the objects corresponding to the items in the package. So if package delivers fires once, it is consuming multiple objects. So you can see that here. So in our data, package delivered happened, let's say, almost 1300 times. But the number of items flowing through this activity is almost 8,000. Yeah, so, and here you can see some statistics. It's very difficult to read, but you can see that the mean value, the mean number of object tokens of the type item consumed by this transition, the mean is 6, and the median value is 4. That's the most frequent thing. So we can discover these nets, and the idea is actually very simple. So what we do is we first flatten the log in the way that I indicated before. So we deliberately create the problem, and then we get PetriNet models per object type. So we mine all the object types separately, using conventional process discovery techniques, like, for example, the inductive miner or anything else. So we mine models per object type, but we know that we are making a mistake here because we are duplicating these events. After we have done that, we are merging these nets together again, and the frequencies of our activities that we have here are converted back to the faithful frequency. So the number of times that, for example, place order has really happened. And then we know that, I don't know, if much more tokens are being consumed than the number of firings, we gather statistics for these multi-set arcs. And so these arcs that are thicker, they are corresponding, and also the places that have these double circles, they are corresponding to the situation where in one firing, we do not take one token, but we take a set or a multi-set of tokens. So this is what we get here. And this picture, it's too complicated. I'm not going to explain it altogether, but this is showing this correction, that if we are consuming 500 items, but we are doing that in 1,000 events, then we get these multi-set arcs where the average has to be 5. Because if we consume 500 tokens in 100 firings, we know that the average is 5. And this is how we can correct these statistics. And then in every view, the frequency is the same, and we can simply put things on top of each other. So that is how, let's say, this works. If you're interested, please take a look at the paper that I indicated before. So this is an example of choosing a representational bias, which is, let's say, more complicated, more involved than what you would normally see. In the second part, and I'm not sure, should I take questions now or at the end, Irina?
Sorry?
Should I take questions now, or should I also finish?
That's up to you, so just, yeah. Or maybe the audience, if there are some immediate questions.
Yeah.
Well, then maybe after the talk,
Yeah. So the,
Irina, sorry, can I ask one, Will?
Yeah, yeah.
Hi. Marco here, Will.
Hi, Marco.
Hi, sorry, I'm outside, so without video. So Will, something I'm wondering about, because, you know, we are studying these different models for introducing data into PatriNets or also declarative models, right? So something that that puzzled me when we go into this PatriNet realm, which has also to do with these Proclet models in the way Dirk has redefined them recently. So the two questions that arise there are, so on the one end, do we need this advanced form of synchronizations where you want to be sure that when you diverge things, then the corresponding convergence transition occurs only when you consume all the objects that you have generated before. Like, you know, I have an order with three items. I can only fire a corresponding transition when I consume the order and those three items all together. And the second question is related to many-to-many. So in my experience, at least, if I see Proclets, but also these OCBC models that we studied together, right?
Yeah.
It's much better to reify many-to-many into one-to-many, because otherwise the representation of the control flow becomes a little bit cumbersome. So I wanted to hear your opinion on these two aspects.
Yeah, so I think that these are very good questions. And my the claim of this talk is not that there should be this discovery technique. The claim of this part of the talk is that we need to come up with storage formats which are not too complicated, that sit somewhere in between that sit in between the real data and real systems like SAP with many tables and the discovery techniques that we did. So for example, if you look at the work that we did together also in the past, and I think we agreed upon that, it quickly becomes too complicated and too heavy, right? One is able to reconstruct an entire database state, et cetera, et cetera. So my proposal would be to start a kind of competition, let's say between different groups, taking this data as input. And if you look at the standard, there is more than what I just sketched. Taking this as input, there are example logs, and let's try to do competitions to learn these models and to evaluate these models and to do that. The models that we are currently generating are underspecified. And like if you look at what is on these arcs here, so if you look at package delivered, you see certain statistics, you don't see a particular rule, right? That is kind of missing in this representation. Future work could be aimed at, for example, package delivered can only fire if all the objects in the package are actually there, right? And the number is variable. So I cannot say there should be two items in the package, because I will have packages with just one item, I will have packages with five items, etc. So we need to have expressions which are different than the normal expressions that you would have in the colored PetriNet, where you are able to say something that you say, I have all items. There is also somebody in the group, Niklas, that is looking at the notion of, let's say, normal forms when we are, dealing with this part of data. And so, for example, you can think of some data as the form of a bill of material. So we have a car, and a car is composed of different parts, et cetera, or we have a container, and a container contains different things. Then you can think about a bill of material. And then you would like to have logical expressions on top of these let's say, colored Petri nets that would further constrain what kind of tokens you would be able to take. Because this model is just showing replay statistics. It is not showing a logical expression what can and what cannot happen, right? And I think your questions go into that direction, where the challenge would be now that we consider this model to be underspecified, and that we would like to learn, let's say, stricter rules in such a way that the precision of this model increases. Does that answer the question, Marco?
Yeah, fully, Will. Yeah. Thank you. And yeah. I fully agree, Will, that that we have to start from data that are not fully general, like an entire database. So this will help us in also shaping the models towards being discoverable, which is very important.
So this, as I said, was one direction. And I think some of you had seen work a bit about that before, or at least heard about the OCL standard. The other topic is probably newer to some of you. That is the notion of lucency. And just like the previous thing, my goal is not to present finished research, but to, I don't know, to generate ideas of things that people could work on. That's the main goal of my talk. So the notion of lucency is not extending the Petri net, but somehow looking at Petri nets which make sense from the viewpoint of process mining. So I think everybody knows things like, I don't know, whether things are observable, tau actions, branching by simulation. You know all of these concepts. And if I try to convert that a bit to a simple, super simple PetriNet setting, I'm now interested in the PetriNet where there cannot be two markings which enable the same set of transitions. It's a very simple notion. And that notion I call lucency. And it turns out that is a concept that has not been researched before. So since my first paper about this 2 years ago, that did not get a lot of attention yet. But I think it is a new topic that was not researched before. And that is interesting. So here you can see, let's say, some of the papers that I wrote related to that, because I became intrigued by this idea that seems super easy to formulate and that nobody looked at in the field of PetriNet theory. So let me, just to be completely clear that we all, let's say, understand this. So the notion of lucency, as is indicated here, is that there cannot be two different markings enabling the same set of transitions. That's the definition. So just to make you used to that. So this PetriNet has four markings. There's a token in P1 that is enabling T1 and T2. There can be a token in T2, then we just enable T3. There is a token in P3 that is enabling T4 and T5. And there is a token in, and there can be a token in P4 that is enabling nothing. So there are four markings, and each of these four markings enables a different collection of transitions, right? So this is lucent. If we take an example of a non-lucent PetriNet, then we see, for example, this one.
It seems that Will freezed.
So it looks like there's something wrong. Will, can you hear me?
Yeah.
So just microphone, yeah. Something went wrong.
Yep. So you can see my screen again?
Yes.
Yeah. So the previous example was a model where for every marking, there was a unique collection of transitions enabled. This is an example of something that is not loosened. Why is it not loosened? If I can, for example, fire T1, and then there is a token in P5 and P2. And in this marking, I'm just enabling T3. I can also fire T2. And if I execute T2, there will be a token in P2 and P6. And again, I just enable T3. So there are two reachable markings. There is this marking that we get after firing T1. And there is this marking that we get after firing T2, right? And so I have these two markings, the red one and the blue one. They are both reachable. And in these markings, the only transition that I'm enabling is T3. So this is not loosened, right? And why did I start to investigate this? Because when we do process mining, we are interested in the observable behavior that we see in event logs. So it makes sense to try to look at, okay, what are process models, where at least if we would know what could happen, it would be clear what the marking is. I can also motivate this notion from another viewpoint. Suppose that you have an information system with a user interface, and people are interacting with that information system, and the user interface is offering certain actions. I can click certain buttons, etc. Then it is nice to work with systems where if I see what I can do, I know in what state the system is. It's a bit of a philosophical argument, but you can imagine that this is related to observability in the field of process mining. So this is an example of a PetriNet that is non-loosened. For these PetriNet, it is probably a bit more difficult for you to see. But if you take a while to look at it, you will see that we can reach this marking and we can reach this marking. And both the red and the blue marking are enabling transitions T1 and T4. So there are two reachable markings that enable the same set of transitions. So this is an example of something that is non-loosened. Here is another example, and this example is interesting because it's a T-net or a Mark graph. So there are no choices in my model. It is also well-formed, life-bounded. It has all the desirable properties that you can think of. And if I look at this model, you will see that it is not loosened because I have the initial state and I can fire T1 and T2. And if I fire T1 and T2, I'm in the blue marking. And in both the red and the blue marking, I'm enabling the same set of transitions, right? So I hope that this is clear. So looking at process mining, I got interested in, okay, it must be simpler to somehow discover PetriNets that have these properties. And then I got interested in that. And I felt immediately that this has something to do with free choice, right? And if you look at this counter example that I showed here with the non-local dependency, it is clear that if you have non-free choice nets, it's easy to create situations where a choice in the future is controlled based on the past. In a free choice net, in a non-free choice net, you typically need non-free choiceness to encode that in the past I did something like this, and because I did this in the past, in the future I need to do this. Although in the meantime I do other stuff. So it seemed immediately that if you are looking at non-free choice nets, this probably will in many cases not hold. Then you could think, okay, let's look at free choice nets. But even if you look at this simple Mar graph or T net, already here it doesn't hold, right? So what is then the property that should hold to ensure these properties? So in the PetriNet paper of 2018 that won the best paper award of that year, I gave a theorem that I actually had to refine later, but that's a different story. I showed that nets that are perpetual, that means that are live bounded and have a home cluster, are guaranteed to be loosened, right? If you look at this T-net here, it is live, it is bounded, but it doesn't have a home cluster. I will explain in a minute what that means. The problem with the PetriNet paper 2018 is that it is building upon a lot of free choice theory proven for well-formed nets. And so well-formed nets are, let's say, PetriNet that have a marking where the net is live and bounded. So it's building on, let's say, existing theories, making the proof very indirect. It doesn't really correspond to, you can prove it, but after proving it, you still do not understand what was now the key thing. So this paper that is currently under review, I prove a much more direct result for a much larger class of PetriNets. And the main theorem in this paper says that if we have a proper free choice net having a home cluster, it is lucid. I will explain these terms in a second. What you should realize is that these nets do not need to be live. These PetriNets do not need to be well formed. They may have a deadlock, etc., etc. So this is the statement. And what is most interesting, but I will not expand on that. What is most interesting is the way that I prove this, which is leading to new, PetriNet tools that have not been studied before, because everybody was always looking at well-formed nets, where the net is live and bounded. So let's talk more about the conditions. So a PetriNet is proper if all transitions have input and output places. So if I would have a transition that would, produce tokens without having an input place, it could produce any number of tokens. And of course, that would lead to markings whether I have 1 million or 2 million tokens in the place, I cannot see the difference. So it's clear that this proper condition is needed for lucency. So nets without having transitions, without inputs or outputs, of course, this property is not going to hold. So proper is like a syntactical requirement. Then there is the notion of a cluster. That is the standard cluster notion, often used in the context of free choice nets. So using clusters, you basically partition the nodes of the PetriNet into minimal sets, such that if we look at the place, all the output transitions are included. And if we look at the transition, all the input places are included. Yeah, so for the people that are familiar with the definition of free choice, you partition the net into parts where you have a group of places and a group of transitions, and they are fully connected. Yeah, so the transitions consume from all of these places, et cetera, et cetera. in a second, I will show an example. And if you are not familiar with these terms, then you will understand. So the cluster notion is a standard notion in Petri nets, and it is partitioning the Petri net into groups of places and transitions that belong together. And then the key point, the key condition, proper was syntactical, cluster is also nothing new. Then the real requirement is, the real key requirement is that there should be a home cluster. And a home cluster means that we can reach a marking where only the places in that cluster are marked and all the other places are empty. And that should be a home marking. That means that we can always reach that marking from any reachable state. This is very technical, and like, if you know these terms, it should be, I'm not inventing anything new here, but if you're new to the topic, it may help to visualize this. So here I take a Petri net, and note that this is a Petri net that is not well formed. It is not live, right? If I now look at the clusters, then we are then we have this cluster, this cluster, this cluster, etc. Note that in a cluster, for every place, all the output transitions are included. And if we look at the transition, all the input places are included. Yeah, so that's the definition of a cluster. So then we have this. And now we have the requirement that there is at least one cluster. That there can be multiple, but there should be at least one that is a home cluster. Yeah, so the requirement for this, this we will see that this net is loosened, and it is loosened because this is a home cluster. That means that we can always reach the marking with P7 and P8. So note that such a home cluster may also be a dead marking, right? It could be like if T1, like if I would drop T8, and then the home cluster may be a cluster without any transitions, where the process simply stops. And so we are for sure not assuming liveness, and you can also see that here the this, if there is a token in P7 and P8, we can still repeatedly execute T8, but for sure we cannot execute any of the other transitions anymore, right? That's the main idea. So if we take a look at it, because the marking P7, P8 is a home marking, this theorem tells us that this net is loosened. So I hope that I teach I'm not going to explain the proof in any detail. What is important for you to understand is that this is a direct proof. The proof to show this is direct. It is not using the standard free choice theory, because it is in a completely different world where the thing does not need to be live. There's a second bullet point. So our nets may not be well formed, may not be strongly connected. So for example, this Petri net is not live and it is not strongly connected. So we are outside of the let's say usual class investigated. And then if you look at the proof, there are several new concepts that at least I never saw before. That is the notion of that I called disentangled paths. And these are paths through the process model where you don't visit the same cluster multiple times. And so you have paths where it is not allowed to visit multiple clusters. And one can prove that such paths are safe. And that's an important element in the proof. There's also the notion of conflict pairs that I will not elaborate on that, but that's also a new concept that is used to being disproved. And I have the feeling that these results are much more general than they are not just applicable to lucency, but they would be applicable to lots of other things. And so just, but I think this is obvious. If you, for example, you look at process mining tools that produce models, many of these models, for example, the inductive miner, here you see the PetriNet view, have exactly this property. It is a class of models that we can already easily generate today. And it would be interesting to explore. What I have been a bit vague about is the relation now to process mining. I told you this was inspired by process mining questions, but I just go into PetriNet theory, coming up with an intriguing result, showing that free choice nets that have a home cluster satisfy this property, which is, from a theoretical point of view, very interesting. I'm not completely sure how these properties can be used yet. However, I know the following, that if we would have a new type of event logs, where the event log would not just reveal what has happened, so for example, event E15 corresponds to activity E, but it not only says that it was activity E, it also says what was possible. If we have event logs that show what is possible and what is chosen, and we assume lucency, process discovery becomes completely trivial, because for every event, we know exactly in which state it happened. There can only be one state, so it's trivial. There is no discovery problem left. It is already in the event log. So this is a bit about the connection, but as I said, the connection is not very strong, but it explains a bit where we come from. So with a student, I've been working on oracles of given also real life systems, for example, workflow management systems like YAWL, or coming from standard event logs, to use oracles to extend logs with enabling information, making discovery trivial. But as I said, this is still very sketchy, and I would like to stop with these open questions. How can we now exploit things like lucency and translucency? And how can we relate these notions to the notion of objects that I indicated before? These are things that I'm currently thinking about that are, I think, interesting. And I'm happy also for people that are interested in this to discuss this this further. So to conclude, I try to extend things to standard PetriNets by explicitly identifying different object types to get rid of the case notion. That was like an extension. In the last part, I looked at this notion of lucency, where I feel that if we are doing process mining, we are particularly interested in discovering these types of models. So an important question is, how can we create discovery techniques that only produce models that have exactly these properties? And I don't have the answer. This is what I would like to tease you with, and anybody that has nice ideas, for example, of discovery techniques for lucent PetriNets, I would be very much interested to interact. Thank you very much. So, if there are questions.
Thank you. It was really interesting talk, and of course, so just too many questions to think about, and that's maybe the most interesting in each talk. So just to see that there are really interesting problems and some ways to look at them. And so questions, please.
Yes, I think that both Marco and Wolfgang raised their hands.
Yes. So, Marco, will you start or should I start?
Yeah.
Please go, Wolfgang.
Okay, I have two things. First of all, I love this very much. This was a typical Will van der Aalst talk that means excellent and inspiring for future work. So I love this. You suggested, say, a competition for this parcel, let me call it the parcel problem.
Yeah.
And I like this problem and I like the idea of a competition, but you suggested to make the competition on the level of the tools. And I think it is more worth now to make the competition on the level of the models. How would you model properly this kind of things? Before you make the tools, you should make the models. And for me, it is not yet decided which models to exist and which are the best ones.
Yeah.
So,
like I don't necessarily mean the tools. I like when I said tools, I meant the algorithms, right? To get new algorithms. So to open up the competition, like I showed on my slides, and we can probably share the slides later. On my slides, there was this OCL standard, and with this OCL standard, there are several event logs providing different serializations of the type of data that I just indicated. So for people that would like to start with that, it's already there. I don't necessarily mean the tools, but I would mean the discovery algorithms, because if we say, okay, this is the type of behavior that we would like to describe, I give you, let's say, examples, executions of something that I would like to describe, then we should come up with models that can actually describe these behaviors, right? And then if you bring that to a process mining space, then the models that we produce should have a high precision and a high recall. The models that I currently produce have a high recall. That means that my models allow for the behavior that was used to learn them, but they also allow for much more behavior, right? And in such a competition, there should be a penalty also limiting that.
Well, yes, you can do the competition as you wish, of course, but my idea would be a little bit still different. That is to compare modeling techniques. For instance, what Dirk is doing is also a modeling technique in this area, and there are some others, and I would like to see them compared, not yet with respect to process mining or to any other application, just modeling.
Yeah. But we can perhaps we can find a compromise, Wolfgang. That is, if we look at the PetriNet in a standard way, then we are basically trying to describe firing sequences or current sequences, partial orders. You choose something that describes the behavior, right?
Yeah.
I think if we go to the level of objects, we are missing in a way such a notion, right? But when we talk about the firing sequence or when we talk about a partial order of events, we know what we are talking about. But if we talk about multiple objects, it is not so clear what we are talking about. So you can think of our OCL format similar to talking about traces.
Okay.
So then of course, it would be interesting to see, for example, your new modeling techniques, whether you would be able to describe behaviors that somehow correspond to the logs that I described. Right? You know a bit my history, like I shifted a bit attention, and sometimes I say, if I cannot discover it, it does not exist. I'm quite sure you disagree with that, but it's
interesting.
But if we want to describe reality, just like in physics, I don't know, we take an abstraction from that reality and we try to describe it, and we should have means of deciding whether we are able to do that or not.
Well, I'm fine with your notion of objects. And if you put into the competition some requirements that, in your sense, objects should be identifiable in the model, that I think would be okay. No. So this may be a compromise.
No.
Okay, this was my first one. But
an interesting question is that, I looked a bit at the new notations that you're developing. It would be nice to, I don't know, have a master student or something like that, trying to learn these models that you're describing based on the data that we have, and then identifying where the gaps and where the difficulties are. That I think would be very interesting.
Yeah. So my second point is about lucency. I was absolutely amazed and surprised that, you see, I'm long in this area, about 40 years, that we never thought about this so obvious notion. It is, when I saw it first, I said, of course, yes, immediately. That's a beautiful notion. And we never thought about it. And somehow it is a reversed view on the world. And we always look forward and never a little bit backwards. So from pure theoretical standpoint, I think it's already a beautiful notion and worth to be considered.
Yeah, when I thought about it, I could not believe that nobody looked at it. And I also asked people like Javier Esparza, Jörg Deisel, etc. And I asked many people, but they did not know it. And I have the feeling that everybody was somehow walking into the same direction. That is also the free choice book by Jörg and Javier is a beautiful book. I highly recommend everybody to read it. But it seems that the world stopped after that, right? That it was all done, and I think this result shows that there are still original ways and original tools to work with these things.
Yeah. Okay. That's what I want to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Wolfgang. Marco.
So, Wille, you also have a question on lucency, right? So if I follow up on the metaphor you said, like you have a user interface, and from the enabled things, I can reconstruct the internal state, right?
Yeah.
I could like pick up on that. And typically, in fact, you could enlarge the interface so as to make it sure that this is the case, right? So that the user has all the necessary information to know about the state, right? So I guess it's trivial to take a net and make it lucent, right? Probably you just need to add the special transitions that disambiguate markings that before would enable exactly the same set, right? But now my question would be, can you identify like cheaper ways of doing that, like without introducing transitions? So are there ways to manipulate your net and make it lucent without going into this trivial solution?
Well, like the trivial solution that you do to make a net lucent works, of course, but there are two issues with that. First of all, by doing that, you will make the net non-free choice, right? Because you start connecting like witness transitions to places to show that there is a token in that place. But if that that place is also involved in some synchronization, you kill the free choice property.
Absolutely, right? Yes. That
would be killing. So there's one thing. Perhaps about this metaphor, it was also partly inspired. As you know, I've been working on workflow technology for a very long time. One of the interesting things of a workflow management system is that the state of any workflow model can be derived by the work that is offered to people. And so if you look at the work list of a workflow management system, like a system like y'all, then what is in the work lists completely determines the internal state. It cannot be that there is something else, right? That somehow doesn't make any sense. So this enabling information in some systems, it is very obvious. It is already there. I offer that the user can do this and this, and if the user picks one work item, then the other may disappear or not. And that is exactly determining the state.
Yeah. Thank you.
So are there more questions? So it looks like everybody is thinking it over, because there was quite a lot of new information to think about. And so then I think there will be other possibilities to discuss and to continue this work. So I think actually we already have posed too many questions himself, so that we do not have our own. So then I would like to thank you once more for the wonderful talk, and so also our audience for their contributions, and we hope to meet in a week, yep, as usual.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot for listening, and happy Easter for everybody.
Yeah. And thanks a lot, Will, for the food of thought.
Thank you, Will.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye.